This is the OMG Book Show with William O'Day, episode number 6.
Welcome to the OMG Book Show, where it's all about taking you into the brains of fantastic authors.
No scalpels required.
It's more than an interview, it's an experience. And now, your host, William O'Day.
Hello, everybody, and thank you for joining the show today. Today, we get to have a fantastic discussion with Michael Stephen Fuchs. He tells us a lot about what it took for him to become a writer, the writer that he is today, and forewarning, harbinger of doom. It wasn't easy when he started, but he made it through. You'll get the details on that. We also get the details on what happened to him after he published his first book with traditional publishing. Hint, he didn't all of a sudden become Stephen King. It was actually far worse than that. In fact, here's another hint. It affected his love life, and not in a good way. I'm not going to say anything more than that. You'll have to hear it from him because I don't want to color outside the lines too far. Anyway, so there's all that and so much more. We have just a fantastic discussion. It's at times hilarious, at times poignant, and he also actually imparts some advice and life lessons that he's learned from the special operators that his books are modeled on. So, surgical gloves on, scalpel in hand, let's get started. I am super excited today to be bringing you a very esteemed author guest and altogether a man with a lot of gumption, as you will find out in this show. His name is Michael Stephen Fuchs, and he's on the line with me today. Michael, thank you so much for joining us.
Hey, thanks, William. It's a pleasure, an honor, and a privilege.
Very nice. Very nice. Thank you. And I mentioned it just before we started recording, but I watched your, amongst the things I do to prepare for interviews, I watched your reader Q&A that I think you had in October. And you were out on a church or a rooftop, and there was a cathedral in the back in Spain. It all seemed very romantic and a wonderful life to have as a writer. But is it always that easy?
Yeah, well, one likes to keep up a certain image, right? Right. I have this theory that glamour is a property that only exists at a distance. Everything looks really glamorous until you drill down on it.
That's true. That's true. That's why all those Hollywood actors never liked that 4K video is coming out, right?
Yeah, right, indeed. Well, you know, like I have friends who work in filmmaking or publishing or whatever. Filmmaking, that's great. Let me tell you how glamorous that is. Sitting on a freezing cold set for 14 hours doing absolutely nothing, eating stale, cold cheese Danishes. Yeah. So the rooftop is a nice blandishment. And I go, there's a place in Spain where I'm lucky enough to have some friends. And I hang out there and I'm able to work. And yeah, it's a nice break.
Oh, that sounds good. And I think I agree with you. It's the distance does make it's like the soft focus back in the old Star Trek days, you know, where just, everything just seemed right. Kind of rosier.
Indeed. Well, my friends in Spain refer to Facebook as the happiness show. So we're all trying to keep up this image of how fabulous our lives are.
Right, right. I mean, that's what I'm saying. Like you go on Facebook and it's almost depressing how happy everybody is.
Well, it's a psychological fact. Facebook is understood to be depressing. The more time you spend there, the crappier you feel.
And no for that way. Reason, really, is there like an actual study out that says that?
Multiple studies, as far as I recall, yeah. Oh, yeah, wow. It's not happy making.
Yeah, yeah, I can see because I mean, yeah, there is a certain. I mean, it's real, but there's an artifice involved. So you kind of like it's like a measuring up syndrome.
Yeah, precisely. Right. And everyone's putting on, you know, putting the best possible moments of their entire lives up on display. Right. Anyway,
maybe it's, we'll finish the Facebook thing. Maybe it's so when we get older and we're all like 90 years old and we're kind of done most of our living, we can go back and see our own timeline and be like, you know what? I had a pretty darn good life and you forget all the bad stuff. Potentially.
There you go. There you go. There's some upside, and there's a great art to seeing the upside of everything. So well done.
Yahoo! Well, I wanted to start out as I usually like to start out, not with Facebook, but that was good, with kind of bringing you back to wherever your roots were with writing. Like, take us back in the Wayback Machine. How did you first get into storytelling?
Yeah, great question. It's a fairly formulaic answer. I could always, you know, string a sentence together as a boy, you know, so the essays and the creative writing and short stories and stuff, you got accolades, and which is a great, you know, starting point, I guess, to get sucked into something where you're very unlikely to ever make a living at it. But I carried on and So I went through a long period early on where I felt like there were only two types of people in the world, those who had written and published novels and those who had not. And I further imagined that it would be critical to any happiness or success I was going to have, you know, to get into the first group.
Well, clearly it sounds like you have identified, or you had identified, the haves and the have-nots.
Well, I'm not sure that's that positive, negative. It's just right. I imagined that this was a thing worth doing. And I had a lot of very mistaken imaginings about what it meant to be a jobbing fiction writer, what it meant to be part of the publishing industry. And I was, you know, eventually disabused of most of those notions.
Yeah, I think we all did starting out. It was like, I can't wait to be the next Stephen King. It's going to be great.
Because that's exactly how it works.
Right. As long as you finish that first one, then it's, you're kind of on the conveyor belt and everybody gets a turn or so, I think I thought, and it sounds like maybe you did too.
Yeah, you know, well I wrote for 10 years, and then my first novel finally got picked up by Macmillan in the UK. And so you think you're in the promised land, you know, this is the holy grail, you know, I'm with a big six publisher, I'm in, I'm done, you know, and then the dominoes, you know, the facade starts to collapse. You get that first royalty check, and I'm like, okay, my first 10 years of writing, my day job was in IT for decades. So you get the first royalty check, and you're like, okay, my first 10 years of writing earned me the same amount as 2 weeks of slinging computer code in an investment bank.
And so the next obvious question then, I think, is what compulsion, what crazy aspect of your psyche made you want to continue?
Well, I didn't. I was actually pretty depressed for about 5 years after I first got published. I was like, this sucks. You know, one of the most soul-crushing things I ever did was go back and get that next IT contract after I had been, you know, a big famous published author.
Oh, right. Because, yeah. You lived in the new world of reality at that point, huh?
Exactly. You know, and there's all this other stuff, you know, like I broke up with my girlfriend at the time. The stresses of launch week, I think, contributed to that greatly. And then, I don't know if this is too off color, but like, I didn't sleep with anyone for a year after my first book came out. Right? And so on the long list of things I thought being a published author would involve, celibacy was right at the bottom of the list. I was like, this is all wrong. What's happening?
Man, that is completely backwards, right?
And it's ridiculous to complain, because I, even in the depths of, you know, my disillusionment, I was aware that I was incredibly lucky. And, you know, like the country music singer Sophie Tucker said, I've been rich and I've been poor, and rich is better. And similarly, being published, I think, is better, but it doesn't solve all your problems. Here's the core problem is, you know, in the back of your mind, you know, being published isn't the kind of thing that makes you enduringly happy, but to endure the years of blistering rejection, you know, underneath somewhere, you have to be imagining, however false that is, that, okay, if I can just make this happen, it's the Holy Grail syndrome, you know, conditional happiness. And so what happens is you achieve the dream, and it doesn't make everything in your life okay as you thought it would. And not only is not everything not okay, but you no longer have the animating dream that sort of fired your whole life at that point. And so you're like, okay, great, what now? And if you find an answer, and eventually you slowly work your way back to it, it's that the writing, the work, has to be about the work.
I like that. So you have to, once you kind of move through the dream, then you dig deep and you get to work.
Yeah. That's very well put, much more succinctly, in fact.
No, hey, I like yours. I just like to repeat things to people to make sure I'm understanding it.
You nailed it. Yeah, you nailed it. And it's a platitude, but, you know, all the platitudes kind of tend to be true as a thing.
Absolutely. I remember, I don't want to go on a crazy tangent here, but I remember the day that my wife and I got married, the guy that officiated for us ended up saying kind of like these inverse platitudes. And I wish, man, this story would be so much better if I could remember with wisdom. I can't even remember. Anyway, they were all platitudes, but they all also held the deepest truths about life. And I was like, oh my God, that's so cool. I wouldn't have thought of that.
Yeah, right. Well, you're lucky to be married, and it sounds like it was an insightful day.
Yeah, it was. So, I don't want to push you further than you're willing to go, but I'm assuming after that year of celibacy, you're back, everything's fine.
Yeah, well, like I said, it was kind of a bumpy 5 years after that. Macmillan published my second book, which was really a spectacular error on their part because it was basically unreadable.
Which one was that? Just so we know.
Yeah, right. So you can avoid that one. It was called Pandora's Sisters, and I love that book. The trouble is I don't mean to sound too far up my own backside, but it was sort of unrelenting. You know, it was very deep. It's kind of a technosophical explore. So it was very deep in evolutionary psychology and cognitive science and genetic programming techniques and genetics and genomics. And then on top of it being very idea focused, the language just real, I just really didn't give the reader a break. The language was kind of unrelenting, both technical, just literary.
Well, that's good. That sounds like the kind of book you would, you know, you'd be assigned in high school and you'd get through it.
Well, thanks. That's a nice cast to put on it. I love that book. But the thing is, there are, you know, like 15 people on the planet who are sort of the target audience for that type of thing, as Macmillan found out to their cost. And this is the really depressing part, was that, you know, the publishing industry is not what it used to be. And even then, it wasn't what it used to be. But anyway, so they had two data points. They had my first book, which sold, you know, reasonably well by the modest standards of first novels. And then they had my second book. And then they drew a line and the slope descended. And so that was it. I was done. They were like, you know, you don't get a third chance. And I met the new head of Macmillan Publishing at that point. I said, you know, if you publish Graham Greene today, both his second and third novels were spectacular commercial flops, Graham Greene wouldn't have a writing career. You know?
Yeah, exactly. And I think, you know, they at least need to go by the three strikes you're out. I think they stopped one early with you.
Yeah, right. Well, you don't, it's all these misapprehensions. People think you get picked. Like, I had friends who thought I must be rich because I had a book published by a major publisher. But, you know, so you imagine they're going to support it. You imagine they're going to market it and find your readership, but they don't. The only things they market are things that are already successful. They throw money after the stuff that's already running away. And so they throw your book out on the display table for 2 weeks. And if it happens to catch fire, great. And if it doesn't, they pull it off and they throw the next guy out.
So I think that a sad history and hard beginnings, but I think that lays a good foundation and framework for the movement into indie publishing and where you're going today. So when did you first get into the self-publishing side of things?
Yeah, that's a great segue. If I could dishonor your segue very slightly and just add that.
Please do.
What I just said sounded very bitter, but in fact, everyone at Macmillan was always very, very nice to me. And my editor and publisher there was a fabulous man, and they were trying to change the paradigm, but the paradigm got the best of everyone. Anyway, so I don't regret any of it, and I'm grateful to them. But to answer your question, yeah, the entire industry changed overnight, and it's kind of an interesting story. So I had post Macmillan, I got picked up by, I was lucky enough to get picked up by a pretty high powered agent who used to be Tom Clancy's original agent, which was quite a boon.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
These are all the ironies, you know, like it used to be the great thing was to have a big six publishing industry contract and a high powered agent. And I've had both of those things and neither of them got me really anything. And
so
then I was lucky enough.
Is that what happened? It sounds like you checked all the boxes that would seem to indicate total success, didn't find it and had to find another way.
Yeah, your second attempt at a segue. So yeah, so I was lucky enough to get dropped by Macmillan, and then I was lucky enough that the agent said, you know, I can't sell your books. I'm sorry, I'm reverting your rights. So I got all my rights back right at the time when suddenly the great thing was to have your own intellectual property rights. And so
industry's...
Yeah, right. And so it's sheer luck. You know, I can't take any credit. But as you noted, the industry changed overnight and the great gatekeepers have been disintermediated and suddenly readers can connect directly with... authors, and the middleman got removed. And so it was a strange experience for me because I had, how it specifically happened was I had a reader of my books who liked them and he wrote me some fan mail. We corresponded, and this is Glenn James, you know, and it turned out he was a writer in his own regard. And then it turned out he was self-publishing on Amazon. And then it turned out he was making more money than I was. All of which I thought was great, but I didn't know, you know, I didn't think it impacted me. But then he said, you know, I've got this idea for a co-written series, one that would sort of involve your explosive, over-the-top action adventure stuff and my sort of creepier, more moody horror stuff. And do you want to, you know, try to co-write something? And my initial response was, no. And then I thought about it for 5 seconds and I thought, yeah, why the hell not? It could be an interesting adventure. And luckily Glenn was very, very smart on the very, very rapid developments in independent publishing, and the changes in the publishing industry. And so we started writing this Arisen series, which is, you know, a special operations military zombie apocalypse epic. And it just took off, and not instantly, you know, we grew it, you know, we've been building for 6 years. And, but so this is the happy ending, which is ultimately, you know, we found our own readership. I independently published my other series in addition to Arisen, which is a straight sort of special operations military thing called D-Boys. And so suddenly I found myself earning a living at it, you know, and it was sustainable. And And so on top of actually getting to pay your bills, which is very pleasant, you get total creative control, you know, and I try to appreciate that. You know, I control the covers, I control the editing, the marketing. I don't do the editing, mind you, but the distribution, the promotion, yeah, it's all the story design. It's pretty great, actually.
That's fantastic. It's an amazing story. And like you, I totally agree that the new paradigm and what has changed since around 2009 or so has just made it possible, obviously, for writers like you and many, many others to make it to readers. I mean, like before, it almost wasn't fair on the reader side of things. Much obviously, there's the author aspect as well, but readers have so much more choice, and they get to make the choices and decide whether or not any particular author ends up having a career. And that's exactly, you know, how it should be.
Yeah, that's a great outlook on it. You know, there's of course backlash when your livelihood is threatened. You know, people push back. So some of the established authors and of course the big publishing houses were not in favor of all this. And so one of the canards they put out there was the so-called tsunami of crap. Without the gatekeepers, you know, they're just going to be flooded with all these terribly written, terribly edited books. You know, and so I mean, like one obvious response to that is you get up every morning and no one gatekeeps the web, but you get up every morning and you find something good to read on the web somehow.
Absolutely. And on the other side of it is I've read, I don't know, hundreds, thousands of traditionally published books in my life, and many, many, many of them were great, but just as many were absolutely crap.
Yeah, that's another great counterpoint. You know, like this is the industry that publishes Dan Brown.
Hey, Dan, we don't mean it. If you want to come on the show, let us know. But I still understand.
Yeah, I take that back. That was very snide of me. I'm sorry. I'm The weird elephant in the room is that, as you know, a genre novelist writing zombie novels, I'm a terrible literary snob. It makes no sense.
Well, you know, people are complex, and that's the way we like it.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah, and I wanted to ask you. You had just mentioned it there in talking about getting started with the Arisen series, and you I think it was the first 8 or 9 books that you co-authored with Glenn James. What were the best things that you found about working collaboratively, and what were some of the more challenging aspects to it?
Yeah, it's another great question. It's a really interesting one. You know, as you toil, you know, writing is a famously solitary occupation. And so you toil for years and people say, oh, you know, you need to get some support and join a writer's group. And my position was, you know, probably self-defeatingly, the last damn thing I want to do is hang out with a bunch of other wannabe unpublished writers. But it turns out something is missing, you know. And so I started working with Glenn, and we would, you know, we wrote. People always ask what the process was, and the short answer is that, you know, we did the story design together, but we each had our own characters and storylines, and then we would write our individual chapters. But we were interacting every day, you know, so we're in a little chat room and talking about stuff and going back and forth, and sometimes we wrote in Google Docs, you know, so we'd be in the chat area, or sometimes you'd be working a chapter, and like his cursor would appear looking over your shoulder.
You're like, and, oh no, what's he going to think about this line?
Yeah, exactly. It's hard to work with an audience, but the main thing is, you know, working on your own, you know, you toil in isolation, you come up with these ideas, you hope they make sense. And then eventually at the end of maybe a year, you shoot this off to some slush pile or your editor, if you're lucky to have one. And then maybe a year after that, something comes back, but it just all goes out into the void. Whereas with a writing partner, you know, you come up with an idea and it bounces right off of them and shoots back with all these sparks with this crazy new version that you never thought of. And all that's really, it's a much more pleasant way to work for the most part.
Yeah, I totally agree. That's one I used to work in the Hollywood industry doing visual effects. And
I didn't know that.
Yeah, and it was a lot of fun. And we solved problems every day. One of the things I loved most about that was kind of what you're saying is you have this really just talented team and everybody's trying to crack the same problem collaboratively. And there's just this amazing energy about it. And with writing, as much as there are many things I like about it. Yeah, at least currently anyway, I don't collaborate with any other writers. There's none of that. It's that own little echo chamber of your lonely mind.
Yes. Well, and like everything, it's a trade-off, but I'd love to hear more about your visual effects work at some point. But even on the writing side in Hollywood, you know, they get this better. So writing partnerships for screenwriters are very common. Then there are the television writers rooms where, you know, you have 6 or 8 or 12 guys in a room all day long breaking story. And I find that really appealing.
Yeah, totally. And speaking of that, and I heard this on your reader Q&A on YouTube, and if anybody hasn't listened to that out there that's listening to this show, go ahead and go check it out. It's super informative and very entertaining, and I'll make sure and include it in the show notes later. But one thing you mentioned during that was, or hinted at, I think, was a potential collaboration with somebody we've interviewed on the show, a very colorful character named Dirk Patton.
Oh.
Are there any specifics to that potential collaboration?
Yeah, the specific you bring to mind is that I desperately, badly owe Dirk email because I've been so distracted with finishing writing and editing and launching the last book in the stamp series. Yeah, he had the very clever idea for three of us to get together and do something that was either linked short stories or we were going to try to do something innovative, but basically not necessarily merge our worlds, but sort of merge thematically. And it would... just from a crassly commercial perspective, it's a great way for each of the three of us to get exposed to the other's audiences. I guess the answer is I've really kind of dropped the ball on that, and I basically put them on hold until I finished Arisen because I just had to prioritize that. But that could appear. It would be it would be a neat project. I think I don't have any details for you because I don't remember even quite what we talked about, but
well, just in principle it sounds cool. And hey Dirk, if you're out there listening, you guys should totally do it because there's a lot of people like myself that would love to see it.
Yeah, and Dirk, if you're listening, I'm really sorry and I'm writing you back tomorrow.
Wait, I'm starting to catch a theme here. I think in that reader's Q&A there was a James somebody that you had not written back for a year or so. Is that how it went? I forget.
Yeah, hearing from readers is an incredible privilege, and I'm really lucky enough to hear from a lot of military guys, either veterans or active duty personnel, sometimes deployed guys, and so that's such an honor and a privilege. And this was a Marine veteran who became a private military contractor and really a cracking fellow, and he wrote me just at a really bad time, and it's hard to keep up, which is not an excuse, but yeah, I had his email on my screen for the better part of a year, knowing I got to write that guy back as soon as, and then my hard drive crashed and I lost him. It wasn't on the screen anymore, but then he popped up on Facebook. And so, yeah, and James, I'm going to write you back tomorrow as well. I promise.
All right. So I feel bad. You're coming on the show and somehow, your list of to-dos is growing. I apologize for that.
It's okay. You know, I've been living underneath the series in general for 6 years. And in particular, I basically spent 2017 writing the last cycle of material. And we can get into that. But suffice it to say, it was a little bit crushing. And I'm just literally kind of the last book in the series launched today, or technically the launch date is tomorrow. It sort of soft launched yesterday. So I'm coming, I'm remembering how to live. I'm remembering what it's like to see the sun and feel pleasure and talk to people. And so it's very timely, actually.
I assume it's awkward at first, but then as you continue, the memories come back.
Yeah, and there's some crow to eat and some, you know, ground to make up with people I've been neglecting, which is, I'm a big fan of the screenwriter and playwright and television writer David Mamet, who I think is one of the greatest playwrights of his generation. And he said, amongst very many memorable things, he said, art is going to cost you, and it's going to cost you something you weren't prepared to pay.
Oh, wow. Yeah, I think I've felt that a time or two, yeah.
Yeah, so sometimes, a lot of times that plays out in relationships, and I've neglected people, and there's no, you know, it's not an excuse, but...
So I totally agree. It's not an excuse, but just in case those people are listening, let's dive into what you're talking about, what took that time, because from my perspective, I mean, the way I really wanted to approach this topic was, I wanted to ask you, how was your funeral? Like, did your friends and family find any comfort in attending it? Because just hammered out a 300,000 word manuscript. And so I'm assuming you died. Maybe I'm wrong. Right.
You're talking about the disappearance. Yeah.
Yes.
It's here's how the process works. You know, like you're noodling, you know where the series is going, you have some idea, you have a lot of notes, and then there's every book I write, I do more story design. So there's this very intense story design phase, which is probably just on the cognitive side the most difficult, because, you know, I really admire the screenwriters because they're just dealing with pure story on the page. As a fiction writer, you know, you can crank out 30,000 words of maundering prose and, you know, convince yourself that it's something happening, but it's really not. Right. So when you drill down to the bare metal and you do design documents and storyboarding and outlines and meticulously design the story, it just, you know, it just really makes your face hurt. And the urge to procrastinate is 20,000 times what it is when you're writing. You know, staring, the blank page is nothing compared to the blank beat sheet. So while I was doing that, you know, but it's not time intensive, it's just pain intensive. And so I did a long story design phase, really starting at the beginning of the year, which sort of got me through the spring. And I was kind of human through that because you do have time. But then there's no choice but to start, you know, put pen to paper and start writing. And when I initially did, I thought, you know, I'm trying to get all this stuff right, art and life. And so I told myself, all right, people are more important than books, or put more dramatically, love is more important than art. And it's probably the only thing that is.
Oh, I love that saying.
Thanks. Yeah. You know, so I thought, all right, I'm going to stop inviting people to things, but I'll keep, you know, accepting invitations. I'll, you know, make calls to my family. I'll try to find some, as they say around here, work-life balance, which is not a phrase you have in America.
Yeah, I agree. It's, we need to work on that. And, yeah. So any tips? I've got a pen here and I'm ready to write.
No, I'm at least more flummoxed than anybody on this topic. But, and in fact, that's what happened next was I was trying to do that and balance it. And what I found was it just became so stressful to have anything in the diary on any given day. If I was going just to meet someone for a drink that night, I'd be sitting there going, you know, I've got to cut this off at some point. And I just, and the writing was so intense and intensive that finally I said, all right, this is it. I just got to cut myself off and just get this done. So for like the last sort of 100 days, I just went from bed to desk and I only left the house to go running. And, you know, I would like call my mother once a week. I manage that.
That's good. She appreciated it. And just to remind listeners and fans out there, what you were working on was book 14, the dramatic and epic conclusion to, I believe it's a 14, obviously, I guess, then 14 book series. So you've got a lot of threads going on to pull together and tie up here. Yeah.
Yeah. And I tell you what, never again with the epics. It was probably 500 named characters and dozens of storylines all trying to converge and resolve. And you have to pay off everything that's been set up, and you have to, you know, do justice to everything that came before, and you got to complete every character journey. And then you've got to, you know, Aristotle said that the key to conclusions and endings, they have to be surprising yet inevitable. That's the core principle. And then there are 50 other principles you're trying to conform to, and it becomes an insoluble equation in a billion variables. And that sounds very whiny and complainy, but suffice to say, going forward, nice little single protagonist, you know, queer single story arc, nice little intimate things. Never again with this, because God, it hurts.
Yeah, well, it sounds like, you made it through, you chopped the wood, you did the work. When did you actually, like, how long ago did you actually end the last chapter? And I'm sure it goes through editing and all these processes, but when was the first draft out of your fingertips and mind?
Yeah, it was actually, not to be particular, but it's 16 books in the series because there are two prequels. And I was actually writing books 13 and 14 because I do this thing of writing two books at a time now, which people don't quite understand. But
I think it might make sense. Is it just so you can keep the threads going in your mind, or why?
Yeah, that's one excellent reason. Another is, again, crassly commercial, which is that quick releases tend to buoy each other and shoot, you know, your author rankings up and get people excited. And then the other thing is I just, you know, you'd kill yourself for 5 months cranking out a 125-page novel, and then you launch it, and 24 hours later, everyone's on Facebook going, when's the next one? For the love of God. Could I take a nap? You know, like,
right. You're about to be loved to death, Michael. It sounds like.
Well, that's the pleasant thing is I decided it's just more pleasant to say in 3 weeks.
Right.
Here's your second book. And then another reason is that it's just such a big sort of epic story that it makes sense to do story chunks of that size. And so you get better continuity and you can set things up a little further ahead because you're working on two books at once. And
that's cool. Sounds like a good approach.
Thanks. Yeah, I think I finished writing, it's all such a bore, maybe 2 months ago.
To remind listeners out there, this is not your typical size for a book. I think you mentioned it was something like 300,000 words. And for listeners who may not know the word count aspect of things, how many pages does that generally translate to?
Yeah, I think the cycle came in at 310 and a bit. And with the paperbacks will probably be, I think the first book is like 499 pages and the second one is a ridiculous 820.
Wow. So that is the prototypical doorstopper, yeah?
Yeah, pretty much. But I hope it reads shorter than it is. That's the other problem, is that the books are kind of victims of their own paciness. So like you periodically get these complaints about, oh, it was way too short. Your book's too short. Dude, it was a 500-page book. It's not my fault if you read it in a six-hour sitting, you know?
Well, that's a great compliment to your writing style. So, yeah, congratulations there.
Thanks. Yeah. Thanks very much. Yeah. It is a nice compliment. And some of it comes down to the story design, which is that, I learned like any series, there are better books and worse books. And I hit a little slump in books 9 and 10, but I think I learned some important lessons. The foremost of which was story is things happening. it's not set up. It's not reflection. It's not scene description. It's not internal monologue. It's not thematic maundering. It's actual stuff. I was going to use another S word, happening. And so if you do the design that way and you keep the prose tight, then you can fit a lot of story into 820 pages, but it keeps moving.
Yeah. Well, I wanted to ask you, it sounds like you're kind of at the temporary end of an enormous effort of writing. So like you said, you're kind of peeking out the door, recontacting and connecting with life. What do you like to do outside of writing, just for fun?
Oh yeah. What do I like to do outside of writing just for fun?
Do you remember?
Yeah, right. Well, it's funny. I run every day. I'm a pretty avid runner, almost by accident. But when I'm writing, the runs are obligatory because I do all the story work on the runs. I'm this maniac running through the Royal Parks of London, whispering sisterly into my arm where my MP3 player / voice recorder is. So I'm recording voice notes the whole time.
And have you been brought in for questioning yet?
No, although I do sometimes run right in front of the Israeli embassy beside Hyde Park, at Kensington Gardens. And I always feel bad for those guys because I just look really dodgy, making their day harder than it needs to be. Anyway, the point, if there is one, is that as soon as I finish writing, I can actually go for a run and just like look around and enjoy it. And boy, that is so great.
Awesome. Well, so you're dictating story ideas as you run. Do you, once you get back and you're actually working on a draft, are you punching that out on a keyboard, or have you tried dictation for that as well?
Yeah, I've been tempted by the automatic dictation software, but it's a false economy because I use software that makes it easier for me to transcribe it by hand. You can sort of start and stop and speed up. But by transcribing by hand, I'm forced to engage with it immediately and know what it is and then drop it into the appropriate, notes documents.
Okay.
So that works pretty. It's a bit of a faff, and it can be, sometimes I'll come back with, 50 voice notes, and some of them are 3 minutes long, and I spend an hour and a half of my writing afternoon doing that. But the system seems to work, so I stick with it. But to answer your question better, I really like trekking and hiking and long distance walks. So I'm trying to put together a new trek or two, which would be great.
Sounds fun. What would you say? What's the best trek or adventure like that you have been on thus far?
One of the last two, the last one between the last cycle material books 11 and 12 in this cycle, I did the dream trek, which was the Nepali Himalaya in the Everest region.
Oh, cool.
Was pretty great. The one before that was in some ways nicer. It was something called the Tour de Mont Blanc, which is a 190-kilometer circuit around the Mont Blanc Massif in the Alps. And goes through France, Italy, and Switzerland, and it's 1,000 meters of elevation change every single day. Ooh. Which, yeah, you feel it.
Yeah, it's good. But I think writers, especially, our lifestyles are, at least the work portions of it, are so sedentary. I think pastimes like that and your running as well, that's huge.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, the physicality is good.
Yeah, absolutely. So aside from physical exercise, does anything else pull you outside of your writing cave?
I went to a sort of club night thing on Friday, which was great fun. It's the sort of Burning Man community, the Burners, meeting up with like some of the other London scenes for like a former 30s era grand Art Deco theater in South London. And it's just full of lights and silent disco and poetry readings and food and drink and dancing and club rooms. And yeah, that was the last amazing thing I did.
That sounds really awesome. I don't want to drive this interview off into a ditch, but am a huge fan of Burning Man. Been there too many times to count. Have you had the pleasure of attending yet?
No, I'm kind of making myself sound more interesting than I am. I have not. And funnily enough, though, the woman I trekked in Nepal with is a huge devotee. And I think she's been to the last 9.
Oh, wow. That's cool. Okay. Well, if you ever do go, make sure and give me a shout, because I, there's a chance I could be there and I could show you a few of the ropes. It's crazy out there, but it's, in my opinion, the way to look at it is it's the best public interactive art display on the planet.
That's kind of what my friend said, and that sounds absolutely amazing. And I got a tiny little taster of it Friday night, so I may ring you up. Thank you very much.
Ah, cool. So we've talked about where you started with writing and what you have been up to recently. If you could go back and tell your younger writing self something key, what would it be?
God, you're gonna hate the answer to this. Well, for some reason, I think back to after getting published when there was that big letdown, and I was like, and in fact, after the second book came out, but before Macmillan ditched me, my editor was like, okay, where's the new book? And I was like, wow, I'm getting heat from my editor about, for years I couldn't pay people to look at my stuff, and now I'm getting heat about where the next book is. But then again, what am I getting out of this? And so if it were 5 years ago or 7 years ago, I honestly would have said, don't do it. I remember getting up weekend after weekend. My first novel took 2 years to write and 4 years to fix. It was a complete freaking mess.
Woo, wow, yeah.
I got just enough positive feedback from the industry to just keep beavering away at it. I would have been much better served by trashing it and starting anew, but I kept weekend after weekend, just rewrite after rewrite after rewrite. And if I had known where that path was going to lead to, say, I guess 10 years ago now, God, that's hard to believe, when I was in the traditional publishing industry, I would have said, it's not worth it. You're spending a ton of your life on something you're not going to get that much payoff from. But funnily enough, as we discussed, everything changed and suddenly it's wide open. And I can take no credit for that. It's just sheer luck. But I would certainly tell anyone aspiring now that there's absolutely never been a better time to be an author of anything. And the sky, it's wide open and the rewards are enormous. And then there's the intrinsic reward as well.
Yeah. Just, you mean the satisfaction of having completed, what ostensibly is a big project, a big effort.
Yeah. Yeah. And, I'm still addicted to storytelling. It's a really deep well. I guess if I go back, I would say, knowing what I know now, I would say, first of all, the thing is a first novel is a very precious thing, and you think I can never do that again. I put everything of myself into this, and it's not true, but that's why I hung on to that one for 4 years. And it's why people do, but if you're an artist, you've got a million of them in you, or you ought to. So I would have told myself, move that flip on. I would have told myself to study more and sooner. At this point, I've read everything on storycraft and dramaturgy and playwriting and screenwriting and teleplay writing and novel writing. And so, I had no idea what I was doing the first time, and you can't be expected to. But it turns out there are some really interesting and important fundamental archetypal principles that make compelling stories work. And I was really late to pick up on that. So,
right.
If anybody out there is brand new to the field, read Robert McKee, read Blake Snyder, pick up some of the classics and then go from there. Sid Field. I'm looking at my shelf now.
Yeah. Is this the, I think you may have mentioned it in the reader Q&A. Is this the giant shelf totally packed with, I think it was nonfiction military books and writing craft, things of that nature?
Yeah, they're side by side. The military stuff is covers to the ceiling. And so that's sort of like my vertical is military. So like to get the details right and get the mindset right and the lingo and the weapons and the tactics. And I've probably read 300 and 400 volumes of military memoirs and nonfiction history. And then there's a small library of everything on the craft. That's the horizontal, everything about storytelling and what makes stories work.
Yeah, that sounds like a whole gob of research right at your fingertips. Nice. So I wanted to bring it back to that reader Q&A that I listened to that we had mentioned earlier. And one of the things that struck me about that was the appreciation that you have for the first responders and the operators and military men and women out there that form the basis for what you then take into storytelling. It seems like you really have just a genuine appreciation for those people doing what they do.
Oh, thanks. Well, it's about them, not me, but, they're out there doing it for real. And I just make up stories about this stuff. And so, on the one hand, I wouldn't get to write these books if it weren't for the real exploits of, our military personnel, and particularly the elite special operators who are a whole breed apart. And B, there would be no Western civilization to have these books in the first place. So I stand humbled before them. Absolutely. And getting to meet and interact and in some cases befriend some of those guys is just, absolutely the best part of this job. And so if I sound appreciative and humble, I hope it's because I genuinely am. Those guys are they're just awesome.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's helpful to keep folks like that in mind when we're writing and we're hitting a tough patch and things are looking dark and it feels hard and horrible. but really it's nothing compared to what they have to do.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And infinitely more important. And I think it's useful to maintain that perspective. But it ties back, you talk about the hard times as well, is that the absolute fundamental operating principles of these special operations guys are basically resilience and resolve. You know, resilience to all difficulties, all hardships, all pain, all loss, and resolve to never quit and to accomplish the mission and to get the job done. And these are incredibly powerful and useful life lessons. You know, it's funny because I talk about that dark period, you know, and then I think it was really reading obsessively the stories of these special operations guys that made me think, you know, they never once quit in the face of a million, you know, training and operational hurdles and obstacles and danger and death of dismemberment and loss of friends. You know, all I'm facing is a little publishing industry adversity. How hard is that? Maybe I can conquer that. All I need is, you know, the right mindset.
Yeah, it helps. It helps to establish perspective, right?
Yeah, right. And it's there's a great guy, former Navy SEAL, and in fact, not just a sniper, but he ran their sniper school, called Brandon Webb, and his books are great. But he encapsulates it very nicely in, I think, 6 words. He says, "Tough, deal with it, adapt, and overcome." That's 7 words. And with those, with that lesson, you almost can't lose at life. You know, whatever it throws at you, you know, you regroup, you refit, you rearm, you go out there, and I think so that mindset becomes one of the major thematic threads of the books I write. It's very meta because it's helped me write them, and then it becomes a fundament of the ethos of the stories. And then people will respond to that. And another nice thing to hear that I've been lucky enough to hear is from a lot of people who are like, yeah, you know, I've been in some really tough life circumstances lately. And I think, you know, what would the characters in your books do? How would they dig down? And, you know, maybe I can find the mindset that will allow me to survive. And in fact, perhaps not the best example, but the most dramatic and certainly an outlier. I heard one from one guy who was drowning. He got caught in a riptide.
Wow.
And he was, you know, running out of strength, and he flashed back to the operators in the series and thought, what would these guys do? Well, they wouldn't give up. And so he swam laterally. I don't think my book saved his life, but the fact that he thought of it at such a time is incredibly, you know, powerful and flattering.
That's amazing. Yeah. I mean, just the idea that there was a possible instant of inspiration that could have moved the needle a little bit. That's just fantastic.
Yeah, right. How lucky am I? I'm blessed.
Absolutely awesome. Well, we're getting near the end of the show, and that can mean only one thing. Welcome to the Rorschach round, where we use ambiguously odd questions to delve deeper into the minds of these amazing authors. Let's get started. We are now at the point at the show where we enter what I like to call the Rorschach round. And
oh God.
What that is where
it was all going so well.
Right. I'll try to make it gentle. Now, where I ask you ambiguously odd questions to delve deeper into your mind for the entertainment and interest of fans and listeners out there.
Entertainment of everyone but me. This is going to be great.
No. Well, I did promise you, I think at one point I wouldn't ask any questions about animals. So that's off the table. You can relax on that.
All right. Well, it's been great fun, and I will do my best to carry this last segment.
Okay. Okay. So for these next several questions, don't think about them too much. Just say whatever comes to your mind as soon as it arrives. Here we go. Look or leap first?
Look.
Love or respect?
Love. Always love.
Thinking or feeling?
Thinking, alas. Not a good thing, but there I am.
And let's see. Finally, would you mind if I passed your number over to the folks at the Federal Bureau of Investigation Behavioral Science Unit? Because they mentioned wanting to ask you a few more questions.
Maybe email, not phone.
Well, I think we've gotten the FBI off to a good start. But before we go, please tell us a little bit about the big project that you just finished.
Yeah, it's the conclusion of the 6-year, 16-book, 1.6 million word series. Book 14 of Arisen, which is called Endgame, launches today on Amazon. There's Arisen on Facebook and Twitter and all the usual places. You can search for Arisen Books, or I'm at michaelstephenfuchs.com. And there'll be other freebies for the next couple of weeks as part of the launch cycle. In fact, I think the omnibus, which is the first 3 books, will be free week after next. So that's a really good way to get into it. 3 books for nothing if you like ebooks.
Oh, yeah, that's an awesome deal. Well, Michael, I will make sure and include all of those links in the show notes so that fans, listeners, readers can easily access them. And I just wanted to thank you again so much for coming on the show.
Oh, the pleasure is all mine. It's a complete blast, William. I really appreciate it and had a lot of fun.
Awesome. We will talk to you down the road.
Okay. All the best to you. Take care.
So I hope you enjoyed the interview today. I had an absolute blast chatting with Michael. Michael, thank you so much for coming on to the show. And if you would like to check out any of the links that he mentioned, those will all be found in the show notes at www.williamoday.com/6. That's the number 6. So be sure to join us next week when we chat with Mark Tufo, author of the best-selling Zombie Fallout series. In the interview, we get the inside scoop on how the various characters in that series relate to characters in Mark's life, including himself. And we also discuss how his books could, perhaps even should, become a Broadway musical. We'll get the download on that and get his perspective on it. So we discuss all that and much more next week. That's it for today. If you would like to be sure to never miss a show and always have them immediately available on your device of choice, you can subscribe by going to www.williamoday.com/iTunes. And if you enjoyed the show, I would so appreciate a rating and review on iTunes. They both help with store visibility, and they also let other listeners know if this show is something that they might be interested in checking out. And I've made it easy to access both of those by going to the same link on my website, www.williamoday.com/iTunes. That will have a link there that you can jump over to either subscribe and or maybe all three, rate and review the show. So I would so appreciate that. Thank you so much. That's it for now. We'll see you next week.
Thanks for listening to the OMG Book Show. You can find out more at www.williamoday.com.